Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
For centuries, Christians have greeted each other on Easter, where one person says he is risen, and you respond with enthusiasm, he is risen indeed. So we are going to do that a number of times today. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Listen to our call to worship. Christ is risen from the dead. Hallelujah. We know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. Let's pray. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, overcame death and open to us the gate of everlasting life. Grant that we, who celebrate with joy the day of the Lord's resurrection, may be raised from the dead, from the death of sin, by your life-giving Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Let's stand together in praise this morning.
Jesus Christ is risen today. Alleluia. Our triumphant holy day. Alleluia. Who did once upon the cross? Alleluia.
Jesus.
now going to confess together, and we have confidence in that confession, because if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins because of the sacrifice that Christ accomplished for us on the cross. And because of his resurrection, we know that that sacrifice was acceptable to God. At first, we're going to confess together, and then we will have some time to confess individually. Let's pray together. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been, help us amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Take some time and confess to the Lord your sins. Now listen to these words of encouragement. You are not in the flesh, you are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that dwells in you.
Let's respond in song, and let's stand together.
The end is written.
please be seated. Welcome, everyone. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
So we'd like to welcome you to Hope Monco. If you want to keep up with information about our church, it's now in a white color. I'm amazed. You can actually read it off of the screen. I'm so happy. So happy. Anyway, please visit our website and find out the events that are coming up. Today, we are celebrating the resurrection of the Lord. One of the ways that we are doing that is by gathering together yourselves and anyone else you felt like inviting over to Mike and Lisa's house. That's my house, which is about a half a mile up the road. Many of you know where it is, and if you haven't come and you need some directions, just let me know. We will be having so much food, and on top of that, an egg hunt. We even mowed the lawn in preparation, so be impressed. Mike has a fire pit going in the backyard. He's so excited. So the egg hunt will be going on, and Esther probably put the candy in the eggs, so if any children don't manage to find them, that candy is mine. So make sure your children find the eggs, because I don't need any more candy. I don't think we have anything else in the announcements, right? So please, let's spend some time passing the peace, but you really should greet each other with "He is risen," and respond, "He is risen indeed today." So let's go ahead and spend some time doing that.
Wonderful. If this is your first time here at Hope Monco, welcome. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. We here at Hope Monco exist to model the person and work of Jesus. Now, for the past few weeks during this season of Lent, we have spent some time studying the different prayers, learning about the different prayers of people. For the season of Lent is to be spent in prayer, devoted to God in preparation for the celebration of the resurrection of Jesus. Today. And so today we come to an end in our sermon series looking at the prayer of Jesus, the true Lord's Prayer, or Jesus's prayer. Now, I have to mention that today on Easter Sunday, as we study Jesus's prayer, keep in mind that as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus together, as we read through the scripture together, thousands, millions of people across the world are celebrating the resurrection of Jesus today. So as we study this prayer, think about it, digest it, read through it within that context, that Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. Now, if Easter is true, Jesus is not just a human being. If Easter is true, Jesus' prayer is of the Son of God. If Easter is true, Jesus' prayer is affirming, convicting, and has real power. The power to change, the power to transform, the power to save. Friends, let's take a look at the scripture this morning from John chapter 17. And I'm going to read that for you from John chapter 17, verses 6 to 26. You will find it on the screen. You can use your real Bibles. I guess we can call iPhone Bibles real Bibles too, not Android Bibles. They're not real. I'm going to insert that as often as I can. Hear now the words of the Lord. I have manifested your name to the people whom you gave me out of the world. Yours they were, and you gave them to me. And they have kept your word. Now they know that everything that you have given me is from you. For I have given them the words that you gave me, and have received them, and have come to know in truth that I came from you. And they have believed that you sent me. I am praying for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. And I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one, while I was with them. I kept them in your name, which you have given me. I have guarded them, and not one of them has been lost except the son of destruction, that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now, I am coming to you. And these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world, and for the sake I consecrate myself, that they may be sanctified in truth. I do not ask for these only, but also for those who believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you. They also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and you in me, that they may be perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and love them even as you loved me. Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me because you have loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, even though the world does not know you, I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made known to them your name, and I will continue to make it known, that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. This is the word of the Lord. Matthew, Mark, and Luke focus on Jesus' prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane. John does something a little different here. And so what John doesn't include the prayer of Gethsemane, but what he does include is this particular prayer of Jesus. And Jesus prays this prayer before he goes into the Garden of Gethsemane. In essence, these are his last words. This is how John is painting Jesus in his last words, in his last prayer before he's arrested, before he is crucified, before his death. So Jesus here is nearing the end of his time on this side of heaven. And it stands to reason that when someone is nearing their end, what they think about, what they say, what they pray for could be what they are most concerned about, could be what they live for. So let's take a look at what Jesus has to say. In Jesus' prayer, as we look at this, we can see his utter dependence on God. And this is concern for the church, its well-being, and mission. So if Easter is true, Jesus is not just a human being. If Easter is true, Jesus, his prayer is of the Son of God. If Easter is true, Jesus' prayer is affirming, convicting, and has real power. If Easter is true, we need to take seriously the church and its mission, and be utterly dependent on God. Let's take a look at Jesus' prayer and what he prays for, and how powerful it is centuries after his death and resurrection. So verses 1 to 8, you will see that Jesus' prayer is about glorifying God. He is praying for himself here, but what he prays is, and how he prays, is that he shows his utter dependence on God. So we're looking at Jesus' prayer. What can we learn? What does Jesus model for us in how he relates to God and how he connects with God and what he is most concerned about? What we can see here is Jesus' utter dependence on God. Verses 1 to 3, glorify the mission. 4 to 8, glorify me as I have glorified you. And at the conclusion of this mission, bring me back to you. So what is this mission to glorify God then? Because that is Jesus' mission, to glorify God. That's what he's praying for. But he's praying for it in a way that he's calling on God to work through him. Utter dependence. So Jesus' mission to glorify God is to make God known, to make his name known, to save people, for all those who believe in the only true God. So how does he do this mission? Utterly dependent on God. You will see in not only these words in his prayer in the first verse, 8 verses, but you will see it in his life in that he is constantly, as the Son of God, orienting himself toward God daily. He constantly orients himself. This is how he fulfilled his mission. This is how he showed his utter dependence on God. It isn't just prayer. It isn't just words. There is real work in here. Jesus, the Son of God, orienting himself towards God, desiring that God be glorified in his living and his working. And all that he does, he wants to be associated with God. So Jesus not only prayed it, but he modeled it in the way that he completed the mission on this side of heaven. Let's take a little deeper look on the way that Jesus completed this mission in making God's name known, in glorifying God. He uses the word manifest, and we're going to take a look at what that means and what he is saying here. Now, Jesus could have done any number of things. He could have brought power. He could have brought an awesome display of power. He could have brought fear. He could have changed things. He could have destroyed buildings. He could have thrown lightning. Anything. Induce fear and say, "Believe in me, for I am God." Now, truth be told, this is the reason why us humans are not God, or I'm not even having access to that power, because I would do that, right? I would say, "We have no time to win people's hearts. Let's bring some fear." Boom. But Jesus doesn't do that. Look at the way in which he completed his mission. Look at the method in the way he completed his mission. Utter dependence on God. So what does this mean for us today? Those in the church. Those who are seeking faith, those who are in faith, what does that mean for us today? When you look at the way that Jesus was utterly dependent on God, not bringing in lightning bolts and fire and destruction, but rather winning the hearts of the people in a humble way, this is what it means. And this is what Jesus is praying for, that the church continue his mission in the way that he did it. And it's possible for you and me. He didn't do it in power. He didn't utter dependence on God. And that's what he's calling the people to. Utter dependence on God and continuing on in this mission. And you, friends, have the same access to this power for this mission. You have the same access as Jesus did to this power. So let's dive a little deeper now. The way in which he did it, this mission, what exactly did he do for this mission? of glorifying God. What did Jesus exactly do here? In verse 6, he says, he manifested God's name. Jesus' ministry and mission was all about making the name of God real. So what did Jesus do to manifest the name of God, or to make real the name of God? He gave them the words, and he lived by it. He gave them the words, and he lived by it. This is exactly in the prayer here in verses 1 to 8. He gave them the words of God, and he lived by those words. He modeled it in the way in which he completed the mission. In utter dependence on God, humility, to also say to you and to encourage, to affirm, and to inspire that you also have the same access to this power. The summary of the work of Jesus finished in ministry is God's name being revealed, manifested. And it's manifested by Jesus modeling it, showing what the words look like and mean. Now, I've got to say, I like the word manifested a lot better. Early on, if you noticed, I used to say, we here at Hope Monco exist to model the person and work of Jesus, to make Jesus real. Now, I got a little talking to after saying that so much. We can all imagine who it is. No one was exposed except you exposed yourself. So let's be careful with these words. And so I like the word manifest and real. It's not that you can make Jesus real. Jesus is already real. So let's use this new word here, that we manifest God's name by modeling Jesus. I like that a lot. And in my personal story that some of you know, Jesus' name was manifested to me, modeled to me. About 10 years ago now, I came out of a church that was almost like corporate church. In and out. In there by 5:30 a.m., out by 10 p.m. My brother-in-law would know that very well. My sister would know that very well. They come from that context. It's a corporate type of church. It's hard. A lot of you guys would know that in work. So I came out of that church, and my wife and I, we prayed through, what are our next steps? How can we go forward? What should we do? I came to a point where I thought, maybe I didn't believe in God anymore. Maybe Jesus isn't real. Maybe I was just a professional Christian. So when I came to this new context, we found a church in the city, in Fairmount, and I met this man named Scott Crosby. Scott Crosby, a wonderful pastor. The first thing he said, welcome, Jacob, care about you. We met before that. He said, I love you, brother. Welcome to this church, and let's partner together. And during this time, I had to confess to him, hey, listen, I'm here and I'm serving, but I'm not sure where I am in my personal walk. I need you to know that. He said, oh, it's okay. I was frustrated, agitated, didn't know, questioning my faith, questioning my journey, questioning who I was. But every week during staff meetings, this is what Scott would say to me in various different ways, Jacob, I care about you more than what you are doing. subtle, indirect, and direct. Every week that we met together, Jacob, I love you. Jacob, you are worth more than what you produce. Every week he said this. And I didn't know what was happening, but after 8 months, I realized what happened. After 8 months, coming out of a staff meeting, I just broke down. I couldn't hold it. And it was a wonderful, awesome experience of God's presence. Scott, I realized, had modeled Jesus to me. That God was manifested, that his name was manifested to me. And made, if I can say, real the name of God. And right then and there, I was affirmed, convicted, inspired. That this book isn't just a book. That this story isn't just a story. That Jesus isn't just a human being that died in history, that changed humanity, that started a movement, but rather the Son of God who was resurrected. And so this name, this story has power. And the way we experience that power is utter dependence on God. Because what I realized in that journey of mine was I was trying to do. I was doing. Not depending. I have to do it. I have to complete it. I have to get things done. And I realized I couldn't. A close person to me would say, Jacob, this is what you do and what you've done for your whole life. You would try to take a square peg and smash it through a round hole. Ah! I got smashed. Utterly. Utterly. And it is only in my utter dependence, because I was forced to, in my humility and humiliation, that I got to see and experience God's awesome power through Scott, manifesting God's name, modeling Jesus. So friends, I'd like to ask yourself, what does that look like today then for you? To be utterly dependent on God. Because this is what we're seeing. Jesus, the Son of God, is utterly dependent on God in his prayer, in his last words. That's what he's concerned about. This is what we're learning and seeing. What does it look like for you today to be utterly dependent on God? Also, as a church, what does it look like to manifest God's name? What does it look like to model Jesus to each other here? I've got to tell you, of all the churches that I've been a part of, which hasn't been many, I say it like I, but of all the churches that I've been to, I've got to say, I am so grateful for all of you, because what you have built here is a place, a petri dish, in which you have manifested God's name to me personally and to each other. And I'd love to encourage you that way and encourage you to keep going. Every person that has walked through those doors would say that right there. Man, it's so nice being here. Everybody's so nice. It's more than nice, though. There's something different. Now, as we see here, Jesus' utter dependence on God in fulfilling his mission, manifesting God's name, then isn't just a story. There is real power that saves one from utter darkness. If Easter is true here, then the church needs to take seriously mission. And Christians need to take seriously the church. Because as we can see, as Jesus continues on, he prays for the church. The from verses 9 and on, it's all about the church. This man's and Son of God and God, his prayer, nearing the end of his time on this side of heaven, prays for the church. In verses 9, we're going to start right there. In verses 9 to 15, you see he prays for the protection of God's people. He prays also for the holiness of God's people. Jesus is concerned for his followers. He's concerned in a way that he's praying for their unification, that they are united. So that they're united in oneness that Jesus shares with God the Father. He also challenges the mission of the church, right? Challenge a church to challenge the world in its unbelief, cynicism, and even hostility. He prays for their strength. He prays for their protection. You follow this. Jesus is praying for the church. Now, I've got to step aside here and explain a little bit of a something in verse 9, right? Jesus, he's praying for the world, but he says, I'm praying for the, not for the world, but he's praying for his people. That sounds a little bad, but you have to take it within context, right? Jesus loves the world. God loves the world. God died for the world. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. Jesus loves the world. But what he's doing here when he's praying for his people, he's praying particularly the church, for the church, his immediate followers, followers of Jesus. So, if Jesus is praying about the church as he's nearing his end, then I think we can say that the church is on Jesus' heart. I think we can confidently say that Jesus finds the church important and necessary. He's concerned about the community, the body. And we see this in verse 11. He's concerned for the church. I am leaving the world, and they are still in the world. Father, make them one. Verse 18, as you sent me into the world, send them into the world, praying that they can continue the mission that Jesus began. He's calling on the church of the people to pray and praying for their mission that they also give the words to the people that Jesus did to proclaim the truth, to model love, to be part of transforming people's lives as he has done. And as you would say, some might say, I can't do this, this is Jesus. But again, the way Jesus did it and the way he modeled his mission is a way that you and I can do today as well in utter dependence and access, the same access to God. So what does this mean for us today? The church is important and necessary. It is one of the primary areas to practice the words of God, where people from all walks of life come together. So, you know, many Christians, they'll say, and many people say rightfully that, you know what, you don't really need the church. You don't really need to be to go to church, to be part of a church, to be part of a community, to be part of a body in order to be a follower of Jesus. Okay, let's refine this. You do not need the church to be saved. Yes. You do not need the church to be in relationship with God. But I have to ask you, if you are a follower of Jesus, and Jesus takes seriously the matters of the church, then can you say church isn't important if you call yourself a follower of Jesus? Can you say that? Can you say that the church isn't necessary? Now imagine that you're having a conversation with Jesus right now. Can you say that Jesus would be fine if you weren't even part of a church? You think that Jesus would be fine with that? We're not talking about your salvation. We're talking about being followers of Jesus. You see, if Easter is true, then Jesus' concern for the church is not just a concern by a human being, but a deep concern by the Son of God. Should we not consider the same? Taking seriously the church. What we're learning here and seeing is that Jesus places the church in a central way. In a central way. Now, let's take another side. I'm not here to make you feel guilty. If you do, you did that on your own. What I'm simply highlighting here is what Jesus is concerned about. That's it. And if we are followers of Jesus, should we not do the same? Out of love, out of gratefulness, not out of guilt. Not out of force, not out of ultimatums. Because you're not facing fire and brimstone. You're not facing death. As I've said, it is absolutely true that you do not need the church to be saved. You don't. Simple belief, as Jesus said. But I'm asking you again and again, should we not deeply consider Jesus' last prayer here? Now, I get the context has changed, the world has changed. And often in the leadership meetings, we would talk about what would happen in the what happened to the church after and during the pandemic and its lasting effects. The church has changed, and we need to change today. I don't know the answers. I don't have the answers. We don't have the answers. But it's something that we all have to come together to deeply think about. How do we flex? How do we continue to connect? The church isn't a building. It's the body. It's the community. How do we continue to connect with each other? Right? How do we stay connected? I'm not telling you, come to this building. It's only in this building that Jesus is present. That is not what I'm saying. After the pandemic, in the leadership, we have discussed this. You know what? Two-thirds, approximately 66% of the people after the pandemic have not returned to church, meaning staying connected to the body. What happened? What's going on? Now, one of the leaders would say this. Well, what we know is this. Church is no longer worth their time. We need to find out what's going on here. Do we need to change in the way that we connect with people? Do we need to change the way in which we model Jesus? What has church been before? Something to think about. Something to chew on. Now, again, I realize that there are a lot of things going on with church. Abuse, spiritual abuse, corruption, moral failure, I realize there's just a lot of pain. And I'm not trying to paint something very simple. I get that the relationship to the church is complex because the church is broken, because it's filled with broken people. I get it. The only thing that I'm saying here, or one of a few things, is that, friends, Jesus took the church seriously. Can you consider the same? Can you consider the same? So if Easter is true, taking the church seriously and its mission is important. Now finally here at the end, Jesus, as he wraps up his prayer, he prays for his disciples. And you've got to look at the way he prays, looking forward to the future and looking forward to the future for the disciples and future for the church. In verses 20 to 26, he wraps it up and sums up the disciples' life in saying essentially, guess what? They followed you and were utterly dependent on you, and they were concerned for the church. They spread your word. They did it all. They did it all. So I am with you, and you bring them in with you also, because they did all of that. I don't know what Jesus is seeing. He must see something special, because from what I've read, the disciples didn't do that well. I mean, you saw one of the disciples betray him right near the end, Peter. You see the disciples constantly bicker with each other in who is better. I mean, I see this in my children right now. Who's better at this? Who's better at that? It's constant. It's like for children. And these disciples seem like they're children. They're bickering constantly. No, I'm better. No, I walked on water for two steps. What do you have? What do you have? One ultimately betrays. Yet Jesus describes his disciples to his Father in his prayer that they depended on you, that they followed you. Even walking into the Garden of Gethsemane, said, "Brothers, let me pray and stay awake." He couldn't even do that, nearing his end. He was utterly alone. Yet he continued to scribe his disciples in a wonderful, positive way. Why? Because Jesus is pointing to his work that covers their work. Jesus is saying, I've done the work. And God, you've got to see them as doing the work. This is the grace of God. And so when Jesus died on the cross for the church, even at that time, he was representing the church to God and taking on the punishment for the work not done. And in his resurrection, in the resurrection of Jesus, we get to see that Jesus wasn't just a human being, that Jesus is the Son of God. And that in this resurrection, he represents all of humanity, those who believe in the words, those who follow the words in spirit, and those who see Jesus as the Son of God, that they are indeed covered and described to God as ones who are part of your church. The resurrection makes these words more than words. Easter gives these words power. The power to change. The power to transform. as it did in my life, as it does in yours. Living in utter dependence, taking seriously the church and its mission to make God's name known. Friends, manifest it. Model it in your homes, with each other. And that is so difficult to do, isn't it? I love my wife. I love my children. But it's work to manifest and model God's name. I really like people. My wife loves people, ish. I mean, look, okay, you know her. She's an introvert and shy. And, you know, she just, she's, as she works in retail, she faces people all day long. It's hard. She comes home crying some days, worn down, beaten. Says, it's hard to model Jesus. I said, I know. I get it. She continues on. She is incredibly faithful, a model for me, because I just want to quit every day. But she keeps going. Friends, I implore you, let's lift each other up, model Jesus to each other, manifest his name. That's the mission. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for sending your Son. Not only to die for our sins, but to live the life that we should have. And in your Son's resurrection, Easter, we have hope. But on this side of heaven, it's not the end, even though it may seem like it, that there is hope beyond. I pray that you give us strength daily to keep us united together on mission and manifesting your name in a very real way. In your name we pray. Amen. Friends, we continue on in worship and we come to a portion of the worship where we prepare to participate in the Lord's Supper together. And as we prepare to participate in the Lord's Supper together, we will pray together prayers of the people. Now, I will pray or read words from the screen, and let's take a little bit of time to pray for each topic. And I will give you a few moments to pray for each of these topics on this Easter Sunday. God of life, we rejoice in the resurrection of your Son, his defeat over death, his gift of new life. We praise you for the reflections of that. New life in creation. Let us pray. In nations and governments around the world. Let us pray. In the ministry of the Church Universal. in our community here at Hope, in Ambler, in Montgomery County. In the sacrifice of those who serve. And finally, in our new life in Christ. Friends, for centuries, Christians have recited the Apostles' Creed to affirm their faith, to remember that Jesus is more than just a human being. In his resurrection, he has shown he is the Son of God and has beat death. And that in our belief in him, we have access to the same. Let us stand. Christians, what do you believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, and suffered death. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us close in responding and respond in song.
If you're looking at the bulletin, it's a different song. My apologies.
Let no one caught in sin remain inside the lie of inward shame, but fix our eyes upon the cross and run to him who showed great love and bled for
Grace to you and peace from him who is and was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us to be a kingdom, priests, serving his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Friends, go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks.